We are the Muslim Ummah, and each day that goes by, the harder we try, in gratitude we pray to Allah. Chosen as part of the best of mankind, we spread the word of Islam. Each man at each hour, in awe of his power, each flower, each tree.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back to our fantastic journey through Islam and its heritage in Europe. Now, I am Dr. Steph Karis Abu Yasser, and I have written a book which focuses pretty much on the Ottoman heritage, Ottoman Islamic heritage in Greece and the region of the Balkans. We finished last episode, episode 10, with my home country, starting actually the north of it, starting with Thrace. Thrace is divided between Western Thrace and Eastern Thrace. Western Thrace is the part which is in Greece, and Eastern Thrace is the part which is in Turkey nowadays. So basically the European part of Turkey is Eastern Thrace. Now, the Greeks, whenever they refer to Thrace, they just mean their own Thrace. And the Turks would always refer to Western Thrace as soon as they mean Greece. So it might be a bit confusing, but again, this is the confusing bit of the Balkan policy, Balkan situation. Unfortunately, I think you have all realized that we are dealing with really complicated matters in the Balkan countries, and it's not straightforward as it might seem sometimes. Now, just to take a look again at the map, which I have here again, about the Ottoman conquests. When did the Ottomans conquer certain, or when did the Ottomans, we should rather say as Muslims, open certain countries in the Balkan area, the Balkan Peninsula? Now, just a quick one. Greece itself was opened with Constantinople, 1453 onwards. Constantinople, of course, Istanbul, 1453, by Sultan Mehmed Fatih, as we have already learned. Now, Albania, 1385, the northern neighbor of Greece. Next to Albania, we're going to Serbia, which was basically opened for Islam in 1398. Serbia is nowadays divided in different parts. It used to be Serbia, Kosovo, Montenegro, all one. Now Serbia is on its own. Montenegro became Ottoman in 1496. Bosnia-Herzegovina, the neighbor in the north of Serbia, basically became 1459 part of the Ottoman Empire. And then we go over to Wallachia, which is nowadays Romania, 1476. In the south of Romania, Bulgaria, 1362 to 1395. That was the period that it took them to take the entire country. And last but not least, Macedonia. And with this one, I mean the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia, which nowadays is an independent country. Now, let's not mix it up. Let's try to stay focused. It might be confusing, but let's try to understand. There is a province in Greece which is called Macedonia, which is the biggest province of Greece. And there is a country which is called former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia. In the north, basically, of the province of Macedonia in Greece. So again, back to this map. Again, you can see Greece and you can see what it says Macedonia, 1450. Macedonia, 1450. Now, with this Macedonia, they mean the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia, so the country which is now independent, which became Ottoman, a part of the Ottoman Empire in 1450. Why the confusion? Let me just clarify this one, just to make sure that we all understand what's happening. Now, the word Macedonia is actually an entire area. Macedonia used to be a very, very, very big area, much bigger than what the province of Macedonia in Greece is nowadays, or even the country Fyrom, former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia, or even a part of Serbia, or even a part of Kosovo. I mean, all these were parts of one entire big country, which is, was called a big area, which was called Macedonia. Now, we're talking about ancient Greece, we're talking about Alexander the Great. That time, the understanding of a nation was not the understanding of what we have nowadays of a nation, of course. They did not see themselves as Macedonians, as a country, as a nation, but it was simply a part where they came from. And this part was extremely big at that time. So it did cover this whole entire area, which nowadays is part of the country, Fyrom, former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia, with the capital Skopje, and the province of Greece, Macedonia, with the capital Salonika, Thessaloniki. So I hope it has become a little bit clearer. I'm trying as much as I can. I'm trying my best. I hope it has become clearer. Now, I know it's confusing, but inshallah, we might go over it again and just see, you know, try to understand it a little bit better. But it is complicated indeed, because, and that it shows you again the complexity of this area. It, so, it shows you again how complex and difficult it is for peoples and different nationalities and faiths to live with each other if they cannot even agree on using a name or a certain, giving a certain region a certain name. Now, again, Macedonia today, I would like to focus on the province of Macedonia in Greece, which again is the biggest province of Greece, the biggest nomos, as it's called in Greek. And the capital of this province is Thessaloniki. Salonik in Turkish, Salonika, known internationally in English, Thessaloniki in Greek. Why so many different names? Now, simply because of the confusion that we have. It has changed so many rulers. It was not just Greek, it was also Bulgarian for a while, it was Turkish. Even the Jews had a very, very long-lasting period of flourishing cultural activities in Salonika, in the capital of Macedonia. So all these people have left something behind. Alhamdulillah, and this is beautiful. As I said before, we should not let anybody else come and tell us Muslims, you know, that multicultural is something that we have to now adjust and adopt because it's something of the modern times. Being multicultural and having a multicultural way of life, it's something that we as Muslims have experienced already centuries before. And not only the Ottomans, but the same in Spain and in Portugal, the Iberian Peninsula, when the Umayyads were there. The same the Abbasids. All these big empires, Muslim empires, were all multicultural, multi-religious empires. So it's nothing new to us. We should simply understand that, you know, we should actually be proud of this even, and go and tell the Europeans that you don't have to come and tell us that we have to live with Jews together, or with Christians, or with other kind of people, because we know that actually already. There's nothing new to us. That's not at all new. So, again, if you go back to Greece, now, take a look at the province of Macedonia. I'm showing you the map again, the map of Greece this time. Now, we have dealt with Thrace already, and we're moving over to the next province, as we just explained, the province of Macedonia, which is the biggest province of Greece, with its capital, Salonika. Salonika, Thessaloniki, will be taken care of in the next episode, inshallah. This episode, I would like to focus a bit on one important city, which is called Kavala. Kavala used to be the city where a very big personality came from. Now, his name, Muhammad Ali. Who was Muhammad Ali? Now, in case we have Egyptian viewers at this moment, now jump up and be happy, be proud of yourselves. Muhammad Ali was the ruler of Egypt. Yes, indeed, he was the one who came from Kavala. Kavala, a Greek city in Macedonia. Now originally, he has Albanian, he's of Albanian background. He has an Albanian origin. He's Albanian origin. So basically, again, that shows the multicultural way of the Ottoman Empire. The Muhammad Ali himself was Albanian originally, was born and grew up in Kavala, in Greece, nowadays Greece, and went to rule Egypt. Until nowadays, his family has still roots, after 5-6 generations, still in Egypt. Mashallah, they're Egyptians now, right? Nobody can deny that. So, a very important point. Now, I would like to show you a video, which, again, is taken from my last documentary, and it's going to show you the Turkish area of Kavala. Can we see the video, please? Now, the video that you can see now is the Turkish area of Kavala, and pretty much the way it was, that's also that the way it still is. Okay, the small alleyways and the cobble streets, and mashallah, it really reminds you of the Ottoman Empire. People who live nowadays in this Turkish area in Kavala are not Turkish and are not Muslims. Actually, all of them are Greek Orthodox. So basically, what we just saw now, the Turkish area of Kavala is mainly inhabited by Greeks and Greek Orthodox people. It used to be inhabited by Turks, or at least Muslims. As we have found out, the people who were Muslims were called Turks during that time, and even nowadays, just because you're Muslim, you are a Turk, for in the eyes of the Orthodox majority in the Balkans. So this Turkish area has still remained the same as it used to be several centuries ago, mashallah. And this is amazing, I find. And it is really great to just walk through these streets, just absorb the vibe and just really feel part of it, mashallah. It is really fantastic. And I would urge anybody who would like to go and see that, you know, Macedonia and Thrace are the best parts of Greece to go and experience the Ottoman vibe still, at least in certain parts of these regions. So, mashallah, Macedonia, Kavala. Now, the next video, can I have the next video, which is going to show us the following, inshallah. Right. Yes, okay, now we can see the video which I actually showed you some time ago, the first episode, which shows a typical Ottoman structure, typical Ottoman houses, the way the balconies, as I explained, I think, at the very beginning, the balconies come originally from the Ottoman Empire. The idea of building balconies that way, sahnisi as they're called actually, these balconies were there in order to serve the women of the harem, of the house, to be able to still take a look outside on the street, but not being seen by men or by other people. So that was the idea of balconies, which originate from the Ottoman Empire. And these structures and this architecture still exists, as we can see, in certain parts of Greece, mashallah. This whole area that we see now is the area which actually also has an imaret, which was a part of basically mosque and orphanage and madrasa, and all this complex could be a part of an imaret, as the Turks, as the Ottomans used to build one always, and they would include all these facilities in there for people who would be poor, would not have the facility to eat. They would go there, they would be fed. And children would go to madrasas, Qur'ani schools were available, all mosques and all this. Now, there is a mosque still there in this city, which is the mosque, which has become a five-star hotel nowadays. Now, it used to be it belonged to the Egyptian government. They sold it to Greece. Greece sold it to a private business person who made it a five-star hotel in the same street, five-star hotel, which nowadays costs at least 150 to 200 euros a night if you wanted to stay there. But it is really worth it. Whoever wants to, can afford it, is welcome to go and take a look at it, because indeed it has stayed as it used to be. Wonderful, mashallah. All right, now, beautiful to see, fantastic. Now, the Macedonians are, as we figured out already, not a special race or something. they are all part of a certain province which used to be a very big province, right? Macedonia. We have, if you want, Macedonian Greeks, we have Macedonian Slavs, we have Macedonian Gypsies. We have people who live in these areas, who live in the province of Macedonia in Greece, but also in the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia. And some of them speak Albanian, some of them speak Aromanian, some of them are speak a language the Gypsies speak, some of them are Greeks. And the province of Macedonia in general is a Greek province, and they actually all speak Greek there. That, as I said before, has changed drastically. It used to be exactly the opposite, actually. Macedonia used to be a province where most of the people would speak other languages but Greek. But we will come back to this one exactly after the break. Jazakumullahu khair for watching. I see you. Assalamu alaikum.
Chosen as part of the best of mankind, we spread the word of Islam.
Allah mentions Arabic words in Quran 11 times. This might be a sign for us to know the importance of studying Quran and studying Arabic language, because it's the door to know more about Quran. Ubay ibn Ka'b, one of the most important Sahabas, advised the Sahaba, telling them, teach your children Arabic like you teach them to memorize Quran. See how important it was, and they are Arabs. Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him, said, learn Arabic because it is part of your religion. Arabic is part of our religion. So how are we gonna study Arabic and learn Arabic together in this course? This basic Arabic course contains 7 levels, starting with the 0 level, the ground level. Each level contains 13 sessions, 45 minutes each, and we have 2 quizzes in each course, and we have the final exam. So inshallah, by this, our objectives is to have a very good domain of the Arabic language, especially when it comes to reading Islamic books. So we're going to be introducing Islamic vocab throughout the course. So go ahead, please, and enroll in our basic Arabic course, as Arabic is the official language of more than 20 countries. And Arabic is the key and the door of all Islamic sciences. So please do enter this door from the correct way, Arabic language.
Huda Academy, your gateway to authentic Islamic knowledge.
Chosen as part of the best of mankind, we spread the word of Islam.
And assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back to the second part of this episode. We were talking, and we are still talking, about Macedonia, the province of Greece. Now, Kavala, we mentioned this city already before. Kavala is the city of a very important personality. He played such a big role, not only in the Balkans, but especially in Egypt. Now, he was the ruler of Egypt. He came originally from Albania, his family, but he himself was born and grew up in Kavala. Kavala is a Macedonian town in Greece, and we can still see his statue in the city of Kavala, where we will hopefully be able to see it on the video, which I have made when I was there, inshallah. And there we can see Muhammad Ali on his horse, mashallah. We can see Muhammad Ali on his horse. So he's still remembered, he's still honored, mashallah, by the people of Kavala. And it is actually, for me myself, it's an honor, mashallah, to see that indeed the Greeks are not all the way that negative towards everything that was Islamic or Ottoman. And mashallah, I mean, this is a good proof for that there are still people believing out there that they were not that bad, all the way that bad, mashallah. Alhamdulillah. Now, this was, I think that was a positive sign, and I wanted to show you that I was myself positively surprised to find the statue of Muhammad Ali in Kavala, as well as his house, his mansion is still there. There is even an Egyptian flag outside there and a Greek flag on the other side. And mashallah, this is, I think, a positive sign to create good relationship between Egypt and Greece, but also between Greece and its Muslim neighbors. Next video I would like to show you is in Drama. Drama is another Macedonian city. Now take a look at this one. It is devastating. This is a masjid. It used to be a fully functioning mosque in Drama. As you can see, we're walking through the mosque here at this moment, and you can see that it's anything but a functioning mosque. It's devastating, it's heartbreaking, and nobody really cares about it. Nobody really cares about this mosque, and it's left totally in a dilapidated state. And we are hoping that the Greek government, inshallah, will once be able to restore and get it back to its old pride and beauty, even if it's just as a museum, like they did the ones in Athens, or the one in Athens, or if it's just for the tourists to see, even if it's not a place of worship, let it at least be taken care of, mashallah. Now, the next video, please, is about the very same city, which is Drama still, but this is another mosque. This mosque was bought by the Greek government for several million drachmas, which means the drachma was a currency before the euro. The euro came to Greece in 2004. That means this building was bought long before 2004. And still, as you can see, nothing has happened with this building. It's there and absolutely nothing has happened. It's just there, you can't even enter it. The other mosque that we saw before, the Sindrivan Jami, as it's called, the other mosque, we at least could go in there, film it, and show the people what it looks like. This mosque here, which is in the center of Drama, is called Arab Jami, and has absolutely, you know, we couldn't even walk in there. So I don't know what the Greek government's plans are, but we're hoping that inshallah this will also be restored and open for the public. Now, as you can see, lots of things are happening on the Balkans, and confusing and sad things also, unfortunately. But also, there is some hope in between, as we showed the statue of Muhammad Ali, as we showed, oh, we didn't show it, but I told you about the mention of Muhammad Ali. So Kavala honors this person, this Muslim still, although he was a Muslim. It honors him still, which is a great thing. But in other cases, we have seen also that the mosques have been left just in a very bad state. The same has happened to other mosques throughout Greece, and we will see also, unfortunately, we will have to look at other mosques which are in the same state, if not even worse. And we don't know really what the idea of the Greek government is, what they're planning to do. Seeing, of course, the problems and the austerity measures that the government has to take nowadays, the problems that the Greek government has at this moment, we don't expect a lot to happen in the near future. We are hoping, inshallah, in the future, in the further future, that something will, inshallah, happen, that these mosques will open, that these mosques will go back to their state as they used to be. If not places of worship, then at least museums or places where people can go and still admire the Ottoman heritage of our country. Now, towards the end of the episode, I would like to give you two, three things. The landmarks that we have seen before in Thrace, but also in Macedonia, some of them, are pretty much Ottoman or Islamic. Like the two landmarks of Komotini are the two mosques. The one is the new mosque that we saw, and there is another one which is the old mosque, as it's called. These are the two names, the Yeni Jami and the Eshki Jami. So basically, landmarks of the Ottoman past, still in a city like Komotini. Another landmark, which you will have the chance to see in the next episode, inshallah, and I'm just going to tell you now, be prepared to see Thessaloniki, Salonika, the capital of the province of Macedonia in Greece, which has a wonderful, beautiful landmark, the White Tower of Thessaloniki. And this has to do with the Ottoman Empire. And what exactly, you will find out after we come back in the next episode, inshallah. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you in the next episode, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
We are the Muslim Ummah. And each day that goes by, the harder we try, in gratitude we pray to Allah. Chosen as part of the best of mankind, we spread the word of Islam. Each man at each hour, in awe of his power, each flower, each tree, everything that we see. Spread the word, oh man, spread the word of Islam. Oh fortunate one, paradise must be won.